you. Thanks very much, Doug. And thanks for a great intro. It's great to be back in Munich, everyone. I'm Mark, for those of you who don't know me. I've been at McLaren a long, long while now. I figure my biggest responsibility these days is to make sure the design team, the studio, has the best tools to deliver on our goal of being the iconic sports car company. And we feel like we're doing a good job. We're going to talk you through what we've been up to since 4 years ago at GDC. And first, I'll introduce you to John.
Cheers. I've been with McLaren since 2017, early 2017, effectively doubling team from Mark to me. And then basically my job role is to oversee all external and internal CGI. But before we get started, here's a quick taste of what we get up to at McLaren.
So, back in 2016, as Doug was saying, we hooked up with our friends at Epic for the first time, GDC, San Francisco, and Francois and the team built the most incredible game-changing car configurator. We're going to show you a little bit about it here. So we used our 570, which we just recently launched. What was so cool about this was that some of the features that Francois and the team built into the engine were some incredible high-resolution shaders that really captured the level of detail into the paint and tackled really challenging materials like carbon fiber, which is our sort of bread-and-butter material. It really raised the bar with car configurators, and it introduced something that I'm mildly obsessed with. I always talk about believability. And what this did for us was it started to allow us to get that level of believability into these sort of tools to convince that it translates basically into confidence. In this instance, for a customer to spend a lot of money on something that only exists in a virtual world before we've even built a physical property. What we're trying to do now, and I think what we're starting to really achieve, is to build tools that deliver this and improve on this for customers, but also work in the design studio too.
Then from there, we actually took that proof of concept and rolled it out to our first production configurator for the 720S launch. So this actually got picked up by Sky News as well for kind of setting new standards for high-end customer journeys. It had hundreds of options in as well, which was great.
Okay, so the next thing in our timeline is this aero experience. We built this for the press launch for 720. What we really wanted to do was give the journalists an educational tool. Using VR, we built it all in Unreal, and it really starts to allow people to understand the kind of integrity behind the design. It's our job to make the cars look beautiful, but fundamentally, those surfaces are not just sexy surfaces. They have to manage airflow over, under, and through the car. And this allows the user to really get to grips with it, to actually squirt smoke through, understand the level of downforce, improve cooling, and so on. It was really, really super successful.
From the successful launch that Mark mentioned at 720, we actually took that step further and rolled out the configurator to all our available models, 570 and so on. And then from there, we go to the next slide. We took a step forward with the internal team. So this was the first time we'd ever kind of brought the configurator internally. So for Senna, we actually basically built it entirely in-house. And this was the first time we created a configurator for our Ultimate Series. We raised the bar to give dealers near limitless control and configurations. This resulted in actually an increased spend of roughly around 40 million. Don't worry, that wasn't won by one customer.
So we raised the bar again, we like to think, with Speedtail. We had to. Speedtail is a £1.6 million car. 106 cars we're building at the moment, and it required something really special. John spoke about this at Detroit last year.
Yeah. So,
but just as a quick overview, we do a whole customer journey with this vehicle, and it's unlimited in levels of customization. So that configurator is really, really special to us. But we've got a customer here that's going to tell us a little bit about it.
VIN number 24, and it's gorgeous. This car is going to be epic. 250 miles an hour. And just look at that interior. Wow. Awesome. So I went with an orange interior, driver's seat with orange trim, and VIN number 24 again, signed, and that's the luggage set, of course.
Okay, so next
cool.
one.
So 2019, we actually launched a new car called the GT, and as you've seen kind of with our configurators, we've always tried to do something different wherever it was kind of bring it internally or Speedtail offer anything to the customer. Essentially, what we did with GT, we've always had the Mark configurator, so not Mark here. We've had a Mark configurator sitting dealers. And then online, we have a separate 2D dealership. And this is always rendered 2D images. And then we have two separate workflows, one for 3D, one for 2D. But we challenge our agency Burrows, they are here today, actually. And then we challenge them to render everything out of UE4. So we have one workstream pipeline. So essentially, all the colors, all the lights, and everything's the same. This means it takes down costs, it takes down time, and it gives us a bit more creative control. So this is what we did for this. So all the images, all the layers and everything, I think it's a couple of thousand images, all rendered out of UE4 now, the exact same file that is used for the configurator. So we kind of pushed the bar a bit further, and this is how we're going to do our configurators from now on.
Okay. So that's all the external, the customer-facing stuff. Now we're going in-house. So design visualization. Track 25 is our business plan. It's a super aggressive business plan. And what it translates to in the design studio is 18 new vehicles between, say, the beginning of last year and 2025, which scares the life out of us. We're already 7 cars into this plan, but we've got a lot to do. And what that forces us to do is to think of more innovative ways of maximizing the design time and the creativity, but actually speeding up the process. The first one, a lot of you have already seen this tool, and we've talked about it before at build events, Vector Suite. That was a response to Track 25, really. Fast track to 3D empowers the designers, really helps speed up the process, and it's become a really, really powerful tool for us. We're the first design studio where all the designers have this as part of their desktop. Neil's in the audience somewhere today. I haven't seen him yet. So if you don't know about this tool, I'll urge you to go and hook up with Neil Johnston. The next tool, then, we had a very, very rudimentary seating buck, just a bit of plywood, a bit of MDF. We've moved on a bit now. We managed to get a bit of budget to build something more sophisticated. This you can electronically adjust in X, Y, and Z. You can put in physics data. You can bake in the UX, the HMI type experience. We can have a simulated driving experience, so a dynamic simulated experience wearing VR headset. It's incredibly powerful, and that is really now the backbone of all of our ergo and design process, if you like.
One of the things we actually didn't anticipate kind of introducing, but it's the cinematic. So we'll show you a cinematic in a second, but we have internal cinematics for all our products now. So whether it's a race car or whether it's a GT, anything, we have these short cinematics that showcase the product and actually the beauty of the car, mainly for internal uses, but we're starting to use these externally. And we'll show this clip. It's all rendered out of UE4.
Oh, yeah. Oh, oh, oh.
to go super fast because we're going to get told off because we've run out of time already. So, very, very quickly, the next thing, we talk about some of the tools that we've built internally. So building on that believability and the confidence that we want designers to be able to make the right design decisions, we've started creating some of these tools. This is the next sort of step for us. Really intuitive, simple to understand sort of real-world tools, but used in the virtual world. And we're getting great value out of these. So I'm going to quickly flick to the next one in a moment.
Yeah, just go.
But you can see how very sort of simple, straightforward they are. So we'll go on to this one very quickly. We can really interrogate the tools. And we've started building a new suite of them for our Ergo team, for our engineering team. And we're going to start to spread out throughout the design and engineering side of the business with these Unreal tools. Right. So
from this, as Mark mentioned, we've kind of created this suite of tools. And this is basically just an EXE. So everyone knows UE4 games. It's essentially just a game we give out to everyone. There's no license issues. There's no problem with install. You just double click and it runs. And we put optimization tools so people can run it on a low-end laptop or a high-end configurator. And basically, we've got a few tools, like Mark showed off, the Explode tool, so we can examine every single part. It's quite an old model, so we don't have all the CAD in. But you can do a splice, and it just works. That's the thing. We want to give tools out to designers or engineers, and they can do anything they want in it, whether it's measuring a section or it's writing notes for the next meeting. They can do that, and that's saved, and then we get all that data back, essentially.
Okay.
So we go next.
Very quickly.
Yep, and it's just, we actually bring this to VR. It's a bit low quality, but we bring this to VR because we find most people actually want to view it in VR and use all those tools where you can explode the car, you can change the environment so you see what it looks like on a track, or, well, in England, we get gray skies quite a lot, but yeah, you can see what it looks like in that, and we're getting great, great value out of this. And the next step for us is to bring this past VR to actually using mixed reality with a few other suppliers like Magic Leap.
Okay.
Yeah. From that, actually, one of the things that we've actually benefited from hugely is actually Previs. So all our CGI imagery, photographs in studio and everything, we do a Previs. So we set up the heights and angles in UE4. We know what we're going to see. We can change the lighting to kind of adapt to what we're going to get. And if we go to the next slide, we actually set up all UE4 sessions, basically all our programs now have a UE4 session where we get the studio photographer down, we get the design director down, and we set everything out. We know exact heights and angle, the focal length, the camera. We can even map out if the studio has enough space to actually physically shoot the car.
Okay.
And then from there, the next step is actually teaser images. And all our teaser images are usually rendered out of UE4 now, mainly because we don't actually have a physical property to render at this point. But with these, we can get pre-sales, we can get customers interested, and from there, it kind of just helps the brand out. And then if we go to the next slide, we actually start taking on, obviously, ray tracing. Obviously, we've been using it for quite a long time, but there's only certain things we can show. But the main thing for us is it's given us control over the content, and it's kind of increasing the in-house production team by creating photoreal CG imagery, kind of like this one here.
So you can see we're getting great value out of the products that are out there already. We're using Unreal to create our own tools now, so we're kind of in charge of our own destiny. And for us, it's speeding up the process, but it is maximizing the creativity. And what we hope is that the finance director's happy too, because in theory, we're saving him money. And that's it, guys, from us.